There's something special about hearing the buzz of the gathering community as we gather in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. A few announcements we need to make this morning as we prepare our hearts for worship. Let me begin by quickly reminding the session. There will be a brief meeting immediately following worship service this morning for the nomination of elders. And then for church, please make sure you're aware of the April 23rd congregational meeting for the purpose of elders. That announcement is in your bulletin. Also, let me share with you, due to spring break, CPW and Men's Breakfast, who normally meet the first Monday of each month, has been moved back to the 10th, so please note CPW and Men's Breakfast April 10th. This week on Wednesday evening, we choir practice only as we anticipate preparing for the Easter cantata. And then on Thursday, please mark your calendars for the very special Monday-Thursday worship service at 6 p.m. Your schedule for the rest of the week is there on there. Please remember Saturday there is a choir rehearsal for 10 o'clock in preparation. Angel's leaning forward. She's got something to say about Easter egg hunt. I'll go wherever you need me to go with it. Yeah, I was going to mention Easter egg hunt, but I'll yield to you.
Okay, let's see if I can get this right this week, okay? The Easter egg hunt is this coming Saturday. We will start at 11 a.m. with a light lunch. We're going to do hot dogs, chips, that kind of thing. If you would like to help me hide the eggs, please let me know. I'd appreciate all the help I can get. And also, I've had a few to ask about if I need help stuffing the eggs. I will take any help that you want to provide with stuffing the eggs. The candy is here at the church, and I have brought all the eggs out into, I think it's Doc's classroom, I think is where I put them at. So if you want to come anytime this week and stuff eggs, or I know Stan said some of member care have asked, so if you all want to get a group together, I'm okay with whatever. I just need to get them stuffed this week. So
thank you. And then be sure to remember, David. Anyone 5:30 Resurrection Sunday morning in the kitchen preparing breakfast for the Sunrose breakfast. Remember Sunrose worship at 7:30. That's a lot of announcements, and I'm sure no one remembered a one of them. You have them all in your bulletin, and please, don't nobody say, I didn't read my bulletin. Fair enough. Are there other announcements that need to be made? If not, we've gathered for the coronation of the King. Let us prepare our hearts. Let us prepare our minds. Let us worship Jesus Christ, King of Kings, Prince of Peace. Let us worship God. For those who are able, I invite you to stand take your morning bulletins and join with me as we respond with the responsive call to worship this morning. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Rejoice, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Look, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he. He is just and having salvation, clothed in humility, riding on the foal of a donkey. Will you join me in our invocation prayer? Father, today, as we celebrate the triumphant entry into the holy city of Jerusalem, help us to understand we celebrate the coronation of the king. But Lord, we want to crown you today more than king of Jerusalem, more than king of this earth, more than the king of the kingdom of heaven. We want to crown you king of our hearts. Lord, would you meet us where we are, where we struggle, where we need to be brought back in your direction. Lord, would you have your way in us, that together we may rejoice in your presence, crying out, Hosanna, save us now, Lord, for you are our King. Glory to God in the highest. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen.
We'll be right back.
our Lord and Savior. We're also reminded that we commune with every church who gathers today celebrating Jesus Christ, crucified, risen over the grave, and salvation by no other name. We're also reminded of the great cloud of witnesses that stand before the throne of the Lord, and we commune together as one on this day. And so, as is our custom, I would like to share with you the April memorials. We begin this morning with Stuart Augustine, Alonzo Ball, Helen Basham, Fred Brooks, Gwyneth Browning, Eric Scott Crabtree, Stanley Dietring, Bernard Lee Everly Jr., Robert C. Everly, Nicole Nikki Fransman, Alibi Galloway, Philip John Harrington, J.C. Head, Annie C. Henning, Joseph T. Howard, O.F. McEwing Jr., Virginia Dawson McEwing, Herman Benjamin Nall, Bobby Yule Newton, Betty Sue McEwing Peters, Mildred Norris Powell, William Lee Prather Sr., Larry E. Purcell, and Bruce W. Rose. Will you join me in our memorial prayer of remembrance? Father, today, as we remember the saints who have gone before, we celebrate the cross of Calvary, the price of salvation, and all who have claimed that victory. Help us today as we remember with fond memories the testimonies of those who have lived before us, who have helped point our lives to the cross, and remind us today, Lord, for those of us who profess Jesus Christ as Savior of our lives, Lord, today we stand as the example leading others to your throne. Today, as we celebrate your victory, help us to understand it is more than a temporal victory. It is eternal victory where you are crowned, not just King, but Savior of all. Hear our prayers this day. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you.
Dear Lord, we use this money and that all that we have for the building up of your work in this church and our community and world for your glory. Amen.
Amen.
We don't either. Is this an omen? You reckon this is an omen? Try the other one. Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand and start to fall, and all those lonely roads that I have traveled on, there was Jesus. When the lights I built came crashing to the ground, when the all my friends were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. Well, there was Jesus, in the waiting, in the searching, in the healing.
In the healing. places. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, I couldn't see it. There was Jesus on the mountain, in the valleys.
There was Jesus
in the shadows of the alleys.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Gail. What a powerful sermon and song this morning. No matter what we go through, we have the promise. There is Jesus. Amen. This morning, I'm going to invite you to take your Bibles and turn, if you will, to Matthew chapter 21, our New Testament reading as a traditional Palm Sunday text. Once you find that, I'm going to ask you to stick your finger right there and then flip over, if you will, into the Old Testament for the book of Isaiah, and there we will find our Old Testament reading for the morning, Isaiah chapter 46, beginning with verse 1 and following. As you find your passages, I invite you to stand in reverence to the Holy Word of God. Beginning with Isaiah chapter 46, Isaiah writes, Baal boweth down, Nebo stoopeth. Their idols were upon the beast and upon the cattle. Your carriages were heavy laden, they are a burden to the weary beast. They stoop, they bow down together. They could not deliver the burden, but they themselves are gone into captivity. Hearken unto me, O house of Jacob, and all the remnant of the house of Israel, which are born by me from the belly, which are carried from the womb. And even to your old age, I am he. And even to your hoar hairs, I will carry you. I have made, I will bear, even I will carry, and will deliver you. And then from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21, beginning with verse 7, and they brought the ass and the colt, and they put their garments, and they set them thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this? And the multitude said, This is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. Will you join me this morning as we ask the Lord's blessing upon the written word of our Lord? Father, this day as we gather in your presence, as we intentionally crown you King of Kings, Lord, help us to remember you are also Lord of Lords. Help us to remember that you are Savior to all who cry out. Help us to remember that no matter what we face in this life, you are there to carry us. You have promised that you will carry, that you will save, that you will bear us upon your wings. Lord, today, would you be present in this worship service for those who are here this morning who have never heard the call of salvation? May this be the day of victory. And for all who are here this morning that know you as a personal Lord, may this be a day of recommitment where we rededicate our hearts that we might be of service to you, looking for your glory and your glory alone. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. And all of God's children said, amen. You may be seated. When the kids parade through the aisles of the church, waving palm branches, and the choir tries to rock us with crown him with many crowns, it must be Palm Sunday. And so, as such, today, together with all Christians, I can't imagine any church this morning without a Palm Sunday message in anticipation of the Easter celebration. Today, we are called to welcome Jesus as our Redeemer and King. On this day, a sundry of voices utilizing a variety of texts, all with the attempt to invite you and I to journey along with Jesus on the way to Calvary's cross. That's Palm Sunday. Amen? Matthew describes a great multitude. Let me begin by saying this morning, this was no small parade. I got tickled this morning in Sunday school class as they began to try to imagine the number of the crowd, of the multitude that is flooding into Jerusalem in anticipation of the Passover. And quite frankly, our simple Western minds couldn't even begin to grapple with the magnitude of the numbers. It was pretty impressive. Granted, there was no giant inflatable balloons. There was no elaborately decorated floats. Only one small entry. Matthew records ancient prophecy is fulfilled as this parading animal announces the presence of God's promised Messiah, proclaiming Jesus King of Kings and Prince of Peace. Hosanna is the cry of the people. With their garments, they line the paths leading from the Mount of Olives into the holy city. Waving palm branches, they sing, "Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord." Truly, this is an amazing sight. So much so that Matthew writes, all the city was moved, saying, "Who is this?" And the multitude said, "This is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee." That's Palm Sunday. That's probably the message you anticipated hearing this morning as you paraded into the gathering of God's people. But in contrast, I want to invite you to consider a different parade. One maybe not as universally recognized, but nonetheless, I assure you, equally historical and far grander in scale. The year is 539 BC. Israel has fallen, and the people of God have been taken captive into the Babylonian Empire. Exiled into this foreign land, the children of Israel are forced to watch as their captors celebrate their new year. It was an annual event, an extravagant parade highlighted by the Babylonian king escorting the Babylonian gods. It was truly an outlandish and elaborate display intended to impress and to gain favor of hand-carved statues laden with lavish precious jewels posing as gods. Get the picture? Understand, it was no easy task removing Baal and Nebo from their lofty and stated positions located in the temple. Preparing them for their annual journey took many, many guys and ropes and pulleys just to load them on ox-driven carts to parade them just out of the city gate and then back again. And along the way, people were forced to line the streets. And as the heavy burdened carts pulled by oxen parade down the street, the people are required to bow as a public statement of worship as the spectacle passes them by. But Isaiah notes that the people are not the only ones that are bowing down. Pulling against that massive weight with each turn of the wheel, the oxen stumble, causing the statues to appear to dip and to bow down against as the cart moves. And this is the scene the prophet describes. As Isaiah looks on, he hears the oohs and the ahs coming from the crowd. And in the midst of all the spectacle, Isaiah calls out the irony for what it is. Look, he shouts. Look how these people are forced to carry their gods around. Look how their gods stoop and bow. These gods are a burden even for the weary oxen to carry. These gods cannot save you. Look, they're even returning to captivity themselves. In the midst of all the pageantry and celebration, Isaiah recognized a timeless lesson concerning the gods of the world. I want to say this very plainly this morning, church. We can take anything and set it up and allow it to pose as our God. Worldly gods can be constructed from precious metals or high-tech electronics. We can build them out of mortar and stone, or they may take a more vague appearance like wealth, power, position, or fame. We may look for our gods in bottles or pills or thrills, but the result is always the same. Whenever we set up for ourselves the gods of this world, we will always find, eventually we will discover religion is nothing more than a burden that we're forced to carry around. Causing us, like the oxen, to trip, stumble, and fall. I get it. The gods of this world may look enticing. Admittedly, there is always an attractive lure. But know this, eventually there is always a high price to pay when we choose to serve the gods of this world. But what about us? Those of us who call ourselves Christians. Those of us who make our way into the house of the Lord each and every week. Those of us who dutifully fill the pews and pay the bills and staff the committees. Those of us preparing for the Easter cantata. What about us? Is that what church has become to us? Has serving Jesus become little more than another burden we're forced to carry around? That's heavy, isn't it? Has being church somehow become an obligation, an expectation laid upon us? Has serving Jesus been relegated to a long list of thou shall nots or a vain attempt in that we are to strive to make sure we're always doing the right thing? A strain on our personal finances or an interruption to our leisure time? Is that what church has become to us? Something that we have to do? Or it expected to do, or maybe even the assumed right thing to do. If that describes church this morning, allow me to assure you, that's not Jesus. That's not Jesus. That's not our Jesus who said, come unto me all that labor and are heavy laden and I will give you more work to do, more stress, more anxiety. I will give you rest, right? Big difference. Why? He said, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So I want to suggest this morning that true religion, truly serving God, living in relationship with God and one another, was never intended to be a burden, an anxiety, or a stress that we are called to carry around. Listen to me, God says, unlike the gods of the world who will always prove to be a burden, will always prove to be a weight to hold you down, to trip you up, to make you fall, to make you stumble, that's not me. God says, remember, it was I who carried you from the time of your birth. It is I who continues to carry you even now. Even as you grow old and weary, I continue to carry you. God says, I am not the burden. The promise is, and I love this, four things I want you to hold on to this morning. God's promise to you this morning, church. God said, I made you. I have made. I will bear you. I will lift you up. I will carry you, and I will save. I have made, I will bear, I will carry, I will save. That's our God. Amen? So as we look at the two parades simultaneously this morning, what I want to invite you to do is intentionally contrast the Old Testament lesson where we're presented with a portrait of a worthless religion, a religion that is doing nothing more than providing a burden that we are forced to carry around. Compare that to Matthew's announcement of the arrival of the Savior entering into the holy city to be lifted up for our redemption. Bottom line, what we want to hear this morning is that a true religion, the true intent of the church, is the worship of the one God who carries us. The one God who lifts us up. And that's the lesson of this Palm Sunday. Our God is the strength that you and I need to carry us through the chaos of this world. Our God is the strength we need. Trusting that our God is always at work in us and for us. No matter what we're going to encounter along the way, I love the song. Jesus was there. Jesus was there. Jesus is there. He is there to carry us. And when the way becomes too difficult for us to continue, for us to travel, God is still there. When the waters are stormy, when the world seems to be raging, God is there. I remember this morning the old poem Footprints. And when there was only one set of prints, that's our God carrying us through. Do you believe that this morning? Let me try that again. Do you believe that this morning? See, the truth of the matter is, far too many of us don't. We think it's our responsibility to do the picking up and the carrying. Too many people are convinced that we are responsible for everything, evidenced by the way we whine and we complain about, well, almost everything. I want to say this morning, our God is so good. God has blessed us with life. And what do? We grumble about life. God has blessed us with love, and what do? We misuse relationships. God has blessed us with responsibility, and what do? We complain about the jobs or the tasks that we're entrusted with. And then there are those moments in life where things really do go astray, when our health is drawn into question, or love is broken, and relationships are severed, or when our presence does not appear to be valued or appreciated. In moments like that, what can we do? I just want to say this morning, without a God to carry us, life can become hopeless, negative, and confused. And I want to say, all of that stands as evidence of a religion doing absolutely nothing. Don't miss this. If your religion is not connecting and reconnecting you to God, inviting God to carry you through the most difficult moments in life, that's a pretty good indication that we are burdened with a false religion and are equally guilty of carrying even our God around like a burden. And when we do, that's when we'll begin to view church as something that we have to do or something that we're supposed to do, explaining why so many people walk through life never fully experiencing the real and lasting joy Jesus has promised to bring. Am I blunt enough this morning? The good news of the gospel says, folks, that may be the world we live in, but there's a better way. There's a better way for those who truly believe that God is still in control. And when we look at the prism of life through the cross, when we look at life through the lens of Jesus Christ, we begin to see our God in everything. We will begin to see how our God is connecting us and reconnecting us, how our God is empowering us to live each day in His love, and yes, carrying the redeemed every step of the way into His promised eternal presence. That's the promise of the gospel. So as we contrast these two parades this morning, the question I call you to consider is simply this. Has our religion become a burden? Are we trying to carry our gods around? Or is your worship, is your faith, is your religion actually doing something? Is it lifting you up? Are we allowing our God to carry us? And that answer is found in the way that we worship. But more than that, that answer is going to be found in the way that we live. Is God truly the center of your life? Or merely a late addition to an already hectic schedule? Do we look forward to the time that we spend with our God, or is God something that we add if and only if time permits? If we can fit Him in. I get it. Sometimes church doesn't seem to be very productive. But let me say that's because I think sometimes we as the people of God, we have a tendency to get in God's way, preventing God from truly being God. William Stringfellow once said that he thought the real scandal of Palm Sunday was found in the apathy of the crowd. I'm going to pause here for just a minute to define apathy. Somebody give me a good definition of apathy. Not caring. Somebody once said the world is sick of apathy and I don't care. Yeah, apathy is not, it is looking on without emotion, without care, without concern. He said that the real scandal of Palm Sunday was the apathy of the crowd that gathered. And I wonder this morning, is that the problem with the church? Universal? Are we afraid to look realistically upon the crowd that lined the street on that Palm Sunday because we are afraid that we might actually see in the mirror faces we all know? Think about it. How often do we gather at church on Sunday morning intentionally crowning Jesus as King, and before the week's end, we found we've only re-entered the world, crucifying Him again and again by our actions and the choices that we make. So this morning, I want to invite you to hear Palm Sunday as more than a celebration of an ancient parade, far more than a call to remember Jesus' passionate entry to Jerusalem to bear a cross for you and I. I want to invite you to hear Palm Sunday as a time of reflection, a time of self-evaluation. This morning, simply the question we ask, has our God become a burden? Something we're trying to carry around? Has life become too heavy? Do you feel lost, forgotten, unimportant, unnecessary? Do you feel rushed and without purpose? I love this. Remember, it was God who said, I have made, I will bear, I will carry, and I will save. That's the promise of Palm Sunday. This morning, our question of invitation simply asks, who's carrying you? Has life become too heavy? Has life become a burden? Why continue to trip and stumble when there's a true God big enough to carry you through? That's the question of invitation. This morning, I'm going to ask that we stand. Miss Lisa, if you'll come back as we sing our hymn of invitation. Whatever you're carrying, this is your invitation to leave it at the altar. Member of this church, and when life had taken her to South Carolina and moved her away, she has now relocated back in Owensboro and is prepared to re-enter the service of the Lord here in this place. And so Judy comes this morning to make affirmation of her faith in Jesus Christ and to request membership in this body of believers. Anything you want to add to that? We did that okay?
You did.
Okay. Well, Miss Judy, it is my privilege to ask you to make answer to the following questions according to the confession of the Cumberland Presbyterian Church. Do you reaffirm your belief in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life? And do you believe the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the inspired Word of God, the source of authority for faith and practice? And do you promise to read and study them for guiding, for living the Christian life? Do you promise to be a faithful member of this church, participating in worship, sharing in its ministry of witness and service, supporting the government of the Cumberland Presbyterian Church, and I always say my favorite part, loving your brothers and sisters in Christ? And finally, do you promise to be a good steward of the life, talents, time, and money which God has entrusted to you, giving of these gifts accordingly to the church. Will the elders please stand? Upon hearing the testimony of Miss Judy and witnessing the testimony of Jesus Christ, what is the will of the body? I need a second. All in favor say aye. It sounds unanimous to me. God bless you. Let me be the first to welcome you.
Well, thank you.
Following communion, we're going to have an opportunity for Miss Judy to gather at the back by the stained glass window, and everyone will be giving her the right hand of fellowship. Thank you so much, Miss Judy. It's always exciting when God adds to our numbers, a reminder that we're still growing, we're still becoming, and we're still in service of our Lord. This morning, it is my privilege to offer you the invitation to the table of our Lord. Behold, your King comes to you meek and lowly. It's a proclamation of peace. It's a promise of hope. It's a royal coronation, the crowning of heaven's King. In celebration, we are invited to his table. Will you join me in the prayer of great thanksgiving? Loving God, we who have feasted on your word, now welcome the divine invitation to share in this holy sacrament. Today, as we intentionally remember your triumphant entry into the holy city, we are forced to recall the cross of Calvary and the required price for our sin and disobedience to you. As Easter people, we cry out, Hosanna, Lord, save us. Save us from our greed. Save us from our self-reliance. Save us from our arrogance. Save us from the chaos of this present world, inviting us to experience along with you Easter's eternal victory over death, sin, and grave. And so in this moment, here in your presence, Lord, we acknowledge the holy mystery of this sacred meal. We marvel how you can continue to take humble offerings of bread and wine and transform them into the spiritual nourishment necessary for life's journey. We bring you bread. You give us the bread of life. We offer a simple cup. You give us the cup of salvation. The wonder of your love is beyond our understanding. And still, Lord, we come with great anticipation. May the bread we break and the cup we drink feed our hungering spirits, stirring within our hearts the very presence of your Holy Spirit, redeeming us in mercy, covering us with grace, growing us for your service. And now, as the children of God, let us pray with confidence the prayer our Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread and looking toward heaven, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. In the same way, he took the cup and he said, this covenant is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me. And so as the people of God, as often as we eat of this bread and we drink of this cup, together we do proclaim the saving death of a risen Savior until he comes again. Jesus said, whoever eats of my body will never hunger. Whoever drinks of my cup will never thirst. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Will you hear the prayer after communion? Gracious God, we who have feasted at your table now rejoice in the presence of your Holy Christ. We thank you for this means of grace by which you have made yourself known to us, reuniting us with the risen Christ and providing for us a foretaste of the promised heavenly banquet and your eternal kingdom. Now send us out in the power of your Holy Spirit to live and to work to your praise, all to the glory of your church. In the name of Jesus we do pray. Amen and amen. Acolytes, are you ready? Miss Judy, if you want to make your way to the back. Congregation, if you will stand. A word on any heart before we go. Amen. Not just in Arkansas, but all. I understand John Lear's family has been greatly affected. There are many that have been affected. Just remember, God said, I will carry, I will bear, I will save. Right? Anyone else? Absolutely, absolutely. Anyone else? Anyone else? Lord, hear these prayers. We lift them up with one voice. Will you hear the charge and the blessing? May the God of peace fill you with his presence. Take this same peace into the world. As children of God, have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Encourage the faint. Give strength to the weak. Suffer with the suffering. With honor for all people, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing always in the power of God's Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.